Hey, I'm Brother Taylor Lindeman, pastor at First Baptist Church in Brooklyn, Mississippi. We're so glad you joined us online today for this sermon. You can find additional sermons at these online sources. I hope that the sermon today speaks to you, and we pray that God will move through it.
Open your Bible with me to Genesis chapter 50. Tonight we conclude the book of Genesis that we've spent so much time in over these last few years as we look at these final verses in Genesis chapter 50. This passage is the reason I chose to preach Genesis. You might think, well, Brother Taylor was the new pastor and he wanted to start at the beginning. No, that's not the reason. I chose Genesis because it's one that's really important to me, that has taught me a lot, despite the fact that it is oftentimes very confusing and not exactly what we would anticipate from our Sunday school understanding. But I chose Genesis because of this passage right here. One of my favorite verses is Genesis 50:20, probably, definitely my favorite verse in the Old Testament, and maybe one of my favorite verses in all the Bible. Because when I was about 15, 16 years old, I had a crisis of faith that led me to the point almost of becoming an atheist. I was posed the question by a person who was quite atheistic, militantly so, if your God is so good, why does evil exist? And this question came up in my class over the weekend. And for many of us, I hope you never have to wrestle with that question. You never have to wrestle with God's goodness. Evil never is a problem for you understanding and believing in God. But for many of us, that is a question that either emotionally and experientially, as we go through this life, we deal with tragedy, we deal with hurt, and we turn to God in that hurt and we say, how can you allow this to happen? For others of us, it's a logical exercise where we see the holy good, holy knowing, holy able God who exists, and so does evil. And so what do we say to that? And it's not just Genesis 50:20 that gives us that answer. It's not just Romans 8 that gives us that answer. It's an understanding, and this is what we've worked through, and this is why it's important not just to preach Genesis 50:20, but to preach all of Genesis before it, is it lays the foundation all the way from at least Genesis chapter 37, where Joseph is thrown into the pit, and tragedy after tragedy after tragedy after tragedy comes his way. And as he, not by his own merit, but by God's power, climbs a little bit and falls again, and climbs a little bit and falls again, and finally is exalted to the second position in command of all of Egypt, we might say Joseph's story is good because he gets a good ending in his power and authority in Egypt. No. He gets a good ending because he recognizes, despite all the tragedy, God was working good in it. And this is what we look at, and it is so powerful that it's not just the Joseph story, it's not just the answer to the question of if God, why evil, but it's the answer to what we're about to catapult ourselves into as we fast forward 400 years by the flip of a page from Genesis chapter 50, verse 26 into Exodus chapter 1, verse 1. This is going to be a powerful end to Joseph's story. It's going to answer questions for us, but it is going to give us this understanding that while it looks hopeless and bleak, it is that very dream that Abraham dreamed, where darkness surrounded him and it was told to him that his children would be promised this land, but something was going to have to happen first. Iniquity, hurt, slavery was going to happen first. But through all of that, there is the hope, the promise that there is hope for the days ahead. Let's look at Genesis chapter 50, beginning in verse 15. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "What if Joseph bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong which we did to him?" So they sent a message to Joseph, saying, "Your father charged before he died, saying, 'Thus you shall say to Joseph, please forgive, I beg you, the transgression of your brothers and their sin, for they did you wrong. And now, please forgive the transgression of your servants of the God of your father.' and Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also came and fell down before him and said, "Behold, we are your servants." But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid, for am I in God's place? As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, in order to bring about this present result, to preserve many people alive. So therefore, do not be afraid. I will provide for you and your little ones." So he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. Now Joseph stayed in Egypt, he and his father's household, and Joseph lived 110 years. Joseph saw the third generation of Ephraim's sons. Also the sons of Machir, the son of Manasseh, were born on Joseph's knees. Joseph said to his brothers, "I'm about to die, but God will surely take care of you and bring you up from this land to the land which he promised an oath to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob." Then Joseph made the sons of Israel swear, saying, "God will surely take care of you, and you shall carry my bones up from here." So Joseph died at the age of 110 years, and he was embalmed and placed in a coffin in Egypt. Let's pray one more time. Father, we thank you for a beautiful ending to such a story. We thank you for reconciliation. We thank you for your foreknowledge and your ability to take the wicked things that are tossed our way by the sin of this world and to throw a curveball at the devil, making all things right for those who would trust in you. Lord, I pray that in this time, as we spend time together in your word, that we would recognize that though evil has been done to us, you have brought it to pass to show goodness to your people. We might not understand it now, and Lord, we might not be seeing how you're shaping that now, but Lord, I pray that the truth of this passage would speak hope to our hearts. And Lord, I pray that as we face hopelessness in our lives, maybe today, maybe in a day that is ahead of us, Lord, I pray that you would remind us of this, that you would remind us of this as we study tonight, and as we continue to trudge through your word, knowing that you have promised and your promises will be fulfilled. Maybe not in this life in their completion, maybe not in the lives of our children in its completion, but we are going to a place where all those promises will be realized and fulfilled in Jesus Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen. We begin with the death of Jacob. Jacob has passed away. He's been on his deathbed for several Sunday evenings that he would speak promises over his grandsons, that he would speak to his children, that he would give very specific instructions that when I die, you better take my body to the place where I know I'm going to be buried, just like Abraham and just like Isaac. Here's my funeral plans for you. He gives them all these instructions. He gives many blessings and many curses. And as soon as dad dies, we find ourselves in a problem. My dad worked in the funeral business for a very long time. In fact, my dad's first job was at Webb Funeral Home in Meridian, Mississippi, and he was a teenager at the time. He had not even graduated high school, and he was on at the funeral home. He went and did some other things for a little while, but it all brought him back to the funeral home. And then he opened up his own monument company. And after a little while of doing that, he stopped that and went back to the funeral home. And my joke was, after so many years with the dead, he then took one step back. And then he was a maintenance man at a nursing home. After that, he's just taking steps back as he goes through life. But many of the stories that he would tell were not the sweet stories of a funeral that was preached eloquently, of a person whose funeral was just so moving, but it was the sad, sad stories of what happened in many a parlor of a funeral home and many offices of a funeral home, of family members who bickered and fought down tooth and nail. And I mean, you can probably put your head together and think of some of the crazy stories that he heard, some of the arguments and the fights, and maybe you've seen some of the arguments and the fights of a relative who's passed away. But one such story he told was the story of one woman who, it was the day of her mother and her sister's mother, the same mother, obviously, who had passed away, and they have this funeral, and they come back a few days later, and they tell of how in the middle of the night of the funeral, The sister had drove to the house, piled all the belongings that she wanted on the back of this giant trailer. And as soon as daylight came and they were supposed to come and go through mom's stuff together, she was off, nowhere to be found. Taking it back across the state, across the country, wherever she'd come from, and sisters left with whatever she didn't want. Man, you can imagine the family tension that comes up from types of things like this. Some families never recover from it. And for Joseph's family, they're intense. Most of what they've been given are blessings from God and are acquired as a family unit. It's not the possessions that is the fallout of this family, but rather it is the animosity that has happened since the beginning of Genesis chapter 37, and even before that in the many wives of Jacob. It is now coming back to a boiling point now that Jacob is dead. Let's begin tonight in verse 15. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, we would expect that the next thing is they wept. They grieved many a day. We get the funeral in the 14 verses that come before this, right? That there was this very long funeral procession, both in Egypt and all the way back to Canaan, and they wept there in Canaan, and they spent 60, 70-something days in Egypt weeping. Yeah, there's the funeral part of it, but it gives us in verse 15 that here's like kind of the first thought. I don't know if this is in the middle of things here in Genesis 50 or if this is chronological, but either way, they recognize that when dad is dead, not good things. Continue reading in verse 15. They say this to themselves. And it's kind of a flashback to Genesis chapter 37, right? Where here's all the brothers, and Joseph walks up, and they see him afar. They're keeping their sheep. They're in Dothan. And they say, oh, here comes that dreamer. What should we do with him? And they begin to mutter amongst themselves. Those verses in chapter 37 speak of them saying to themselves. And here again, they begin to conspire in verse 15. What if Joseph bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong which we have done to him? Immediately, their minds go to saving their own skin. Dad's dead. That means our protection's gone. Somehow they have understood in all the passages that we've read, no interpretation like this is to be found, but somehow they've understood that dad was the only thing keeping Joseph from killing them. They realized that he wanted to see dad, and they thought, if we'll bring him Jacob, he won't kill us. He knows who we are. Here's our last resort. Bring in dad. They bring dad to Egypt. He's their protection. That's how they see things. That's their perspective of things. But we've read through the interpretation of everything that's led up to this. And though Joseph has done wrong, he is not sinless. Never for a moment does it make us indicate in any way to us that Joseph is at bay and is not as Esau, foaming at the mouth, ready to kill his own brothers. If it weren't for dad. It is interesting though, right? Isn't this what happened in the Jacob-Esau story? The only thing that kept Esau at bay is mom and dad. And here we have again this kind of understanding of, what if this is just like what happened to dad and uncle? What if now that dad's out of the way, Joseph is going to make us pay? What if this funeral and this loss upsets him to the point that now he's going to kill us? These are kind of the things that are going through their head as this goes on. And for many of us, for many of our families, this is what death does. It brings out the worst of fighting, the worst of argumentation. It brings out that that's mine, that's not yours, get your hands off. Mom always said she wanted me to have that. It brings out those types of emotions, those type of anger, those types of fights. And here it's happening for Joseph and his brothers. And so what do they do? Well, we're not getting out of town. We're living the good life in Egypt. We're not going to maybe try to kill Joseph before he kills us. We got a better plan than that because all their plans have worked so good up until this point, right? I mean, they just live a life of bad ideas. And like, you got 11 brothers here who are making ideas together. And you've got Joseph making his, getting out of it all by, not all by himself, but with God through it all, right? And so here, the bad idea crew gets back together, all 11 brothers. And let's figure out what we can do. Verse 16, here's their big idea. So they sent a message to Joseph. And you have to ask, like, okay, how? You're like, let's put some things together here. Where are they? Egypt. What do they speak in Egypt? Egyptian. Who was the translator through all of this? There were some translators in Egypt, but who's the only one of these Hebrews who speaks both Hebrew and Egyptian? Joseph. So what, do they write him a letter and they fold it up in a paper airplane and they throw it to him? Do they find an Egyptian who's not on Joseph's side because he's second in command of all of Egypt, and they pull him aside and they're like, hey, didn't you hear what my dad said? Oh, you didn't because you don't speak Hebrew? Well, how are you talking to me right now? Like, I don't understand exactly what they thought was going to be the thing that happened here. But somehow they send a message to him. Surely they can write it. Surely they could send it via a messenger. Maybe they can get one of their own kin to take it. But they send a message. This is their idea. And what's the message? It's not, please spare us. It's dad said. Now, we have to ask before we go any further, did dad say? It would seem, by all accounts in the Bible, dad didn't say this. I mean, if you want to stretch it, you can go back to the blessings and you can hear the blessings and kind of this prophecy over the children of Israel and think, well, dad wanted us. He prophesied that we would live. He prophesied that Zebulun or whoever would live by the sea and we would be fishermen. So how can that happen if you kill us all? Please don't hurt us. I think they're lying. That's the point, right? And this happens too. Did mom really say that she wanted you to have that? Ought you really be fighting right now? It happens a lot. Maybe you've experienced it. They send a message to Joseph saying, your father charged us before he died. And like, let's pause one more time. I mean, like, I just got to poke holes all in it, right? Joseph was there when his father died. So at what point did he charge them before he died? He was there before he called his sons in, because you remember back in Genesis chapter 48, he's blessing Joseph's sons, Genesis chapter 49, and then he gathered the sons of Jacob, the sons of Israel. Joseph was already there. Now the other 11 enter the room. This is a far-fetched idea. Your father charged before he died, saying, verse 17 is the message, say this to Joseph. This is Jacob's dying wish. So they say, they're fudging it. Please forgive, I beg you, the transgression of your brothers and their sin, for they did you wrong. Look at the message. The charge to Joseph is, please forgive, I beg of you, the transgression of your brothers and their sin. So he's asking Joseph to forgive them. If you don't do anything else, forgive. Now I have to ask again, we have to reflect back on the entire narrative. Has Joseph forgave? I would say yes. I would say he forgave back in the speech to Judah back in, I think it was Genesis chapter 45, 44 maybe. He's been forgave them. We've lived several years in Egypt with forgiveness, with reconciliation. These have been points throughout my sermons that this family has come back together. But it crops its ugly head up again now. I think that's the point. But look what they also do with the letter. Not only ought they to forgive, but there's an admission of guilt as well. For they did you wrong. By the lie, by the pen of the brothers, they admit their guiltiness as well. Joseph doesn't know that. It's from the lips, so to speak, of Jacob, but they admit this transgression before him. And now, this is a continuation of the letter. Please forgive the transgression of the servants of the God of your father. It's kind of a closing out. Here's what I want you to say. And then this is what he said to the brothers. And when it's delivered to him, Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Whether or not They were right in sending the letter. It grieves Joseph. And when there's any type of animosity in our families, especially in a time as hard and difficult as this, it not only brings anger, but it also brings hurt. And many of us, I don't know, maybe you, but certainly of the stories my father told me, there's a lot of people out there who have hurt feelings for a brother, for a sister, for an aunt, for an uncle, for a great uncle, for a great aunt, for a grandparent, for a mom, for a dad. Maybe it's surrounding death. Maybe it's not. But somebody has to be the bigger person. And here, it's not the 11. The 11, though their note asks for forgiveness, they do it through a lie. And why do they do it? To save their own skin. That's what they want out of dad's death. But Joseph's answer is not, I forgive you. It's, I already forgave you. It's more than that. It's, God has brought about good in all of this. And so I think an application for us before we get too deep into the big issues of this text is Christians ought to be the bigger person. We are the only people, through the power of the Holy Spirit and God, who can reconcile our relationships with harmed family. And trust me, I have those harmed relationships too. I need to listen to this as much as anybody else. Every single one of us has a person, if not a whole bunch of people in our family, who we have harmed a relationship at one time or another. And if the ending of Genesis doesn't tell us anything, look at Genesis chapter 37 and the hatred in this family. Go back even further than that to all the sister wives and the tension that they are brawling it out in Jacob's house. And all of this is built up for so many years. But after that, as we make it into Exodus, on the other side, it ain't Joseph's kids, Zebulun's kids, Naphtali's kids, Levi's kids. They're not fighting no more. What are they doing? They're surviving together as God's people in Egypt. There has to come a day where somebody's the bigger person and says, I forgive you. I'll do it. I'm sorry. You know what? Take it. Because moth and rust will destroy, but I am not worried about mama's stuff, grandmama's stuff, auntie's stuff. You know why? Because I would rather this family. I would rather treat you kindly. I would rather say, you know what? You're going to have to pay for that. You're going to have to speak to that one day. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to love you anyway. That's a hard thing to do. It's a really hard thing to do if you sit in this seat and you say, that's the person I ain't talked to in 20 years. But at the end of the day, here, Joseph is the bigger person. And we see that flesh out in, I think, some very heavy-hitting responses he's going to give us. And I'm departing from this part now because I think he has much more to say in his response. But what we do need to see in his response before we get there is Joseph's the bigger person. We enter in now, though, to verses 18 through 21. There's a hope for the family in these first few verses. But the family soon becomes God's people. And that opens us up not just to the issue of Israel coming in Egypt, but it opens us up to what Joseph's about to say hits home for all of us and our theological situation, our spiritual situation, even right now, beginning in verse 18. They deliver the message. And it's interesting because verse 17, it says they spoke. But then in verse 18, it says, his brothers came and fell down. Well, how could they speak, but now they're coming and falling down? It couldn't have been them that gave the message. Then his brothers also came and fell down before him and said, behold, we are your servants. A flashback to the very beginning of this all again, right? What's Joseph's dream? You're going to bow down before him. And that's already been accomplished with all that has come up before this. But here it reminds us one more time. What's it reminding us? That God has promised. God has spoke, albeit through a dream, but he spoke, and now it's coming to pass. And it's important because his promises, that's what we're hoping on. That's what's going to give us the push into the future, is that he's promised. There's a hope and a belief and a truth that he will follow through with these things. And here is a glimpse of that in a reminder of the dream. They fall down. Behold, we are your servants. But Joseph, verse 19, he says this to them. Do not be afraid, for am I in God's place? What's he saying? I don't have the power to kill you. I don't have the power to be angry at you. I don't have the power to judge you and to sit in judgment over you. Even though I'm second in command, I'm not in God's place. Instead, let me show you what God's place looks like. Let me show you what God has done in all of this. Verse 20. As for you, you meant evil against me. How do they mean evil against him? They threw him in a pit. In fact, over that pit, they said, let's kill him. Let's put an end to his dreams right now. Literally in the Hebrew of Genesis chapter 37, the understanding of what the brothers say above the pit is, he's not going to dream no more. We're going to make it where he doesn't dream again. It is violent. It is vicious what they say to him. Even though they didn't even do the most evil thing in killing him, what do? They sold him into slavery. They faked his death. They lied to Dad. They lied again right now. Everything they've done against him. If it were to weigh out, the weights are in favor of, you've done evil against me. You've harbored no good against me. But when I look at your handiwork, when I look at what you've done, when I recount the pit which you threw me in, I don't think about the evil you've done to me. But God meant it, orchestrated it, brought it to pass for good. Now pause with me here, because this is big. They did evil. By their very hands, they threw him in the pit. By their very lips, they spoke, I want to kill him. By their very actions, they made a transaction to sell him into slavery. They did all of these things. And in response to that, he says, but God's hands, when you took your hands and you threw me into the pit, God meant that for good. When your lips spoke, let's kill this brother, God meant it for good. When I was sold by this evil transaction into slavery, into Egypt, you meant it for evil, but God orchestrated that transgression, that transaction, for good. Now, the big theological question we have to ask, and I think the way I just played that out makes it look like God moved their hands. God moved their lips. God made the transaction. I don't affirm that. But I do think God is there in the middle of that evil, and he is orchestrating. He is making things that were meant to be brought to pass for bad, for suffering, for sorrow, for evil. And he's tying it all up in this big interconnected web that we could never understand that good would come to pass. How so? He continues in verse 20. In order to bring about this present result. What is that result? To preserve many people alive. God allowed Joseph to be thrown into the pit, to be sold into slavery. Take it a step further, even further than the evil the brothers did. Allowed him to be thrown into the pit, sold into slavery, betrayed in Potiphar's house by the adulteress Potiphar's wife, to be thrown into jail, to get a vision, to speak over the dreams of these bakers and cupbearers, to be forgotten. God used all of these things. Why? Because if he hadn't been thrown in the pit, if he hadn't been sold into slavery, if he hadn't have been accused of adultery, if he hadn't have been thrown into prison, if he hadn't have been forgotten until it was just the right time, Egypt, Canaan, all of the land would be destroyed. God orchestrated that. And what did it cost? It cost all the suffering that Joseph went through. And this is a hard, very difficult thing for us to understand in our present reality as creatures who exist and perpetuate through time, but we serve a God who is all-knowing, who exists outside of space and time, and he understands, and this is what blows our mind, God understands everything that goes on. More than that, he understands everything that could be. What if I said one word different in the sermon? What if I did one thing different? What if I didn't use my blinker when I was coming down the road? God knows all of the different results of what would happen if we do every single consequential thing in this life. He knows everything to the point that it's not just he knows how things will unfold, but he knows what will happen if we change those things ahead of time. He knows it all. That's how big he is. And don't misunderstand me to be speaking on how God intervenes in these things, but that he is so big, because I can't wrap my brain around that. But that God is so big that he understood if these things had not come to pass, the present good result would not come to be. This is Joseph's story. And he sees in all of this the way that God was working in it. And I wish that God was so clear that he would speak to every one of our stories and say, this is why the bad thing happened to you. This is why the bad thing happened to me. This is why the tragedy occurred. That you would be able to see all of the different things that God is doing. But he doesn't tell us all those things. But here's the hope that he does give us. And this is why this is one of my favorite verses and I cling to it. Is that I can know I serve a good God, and he can exist in the same reality as evil, because men do evil, and God takes the evil that man does, and he brings it about for a greater good in his landscape. The devil is laughing and chuckling, and he thinks he is winning. This is what happened to Christ on the cross, is it not? That Jesus is hanging there, and the Son of God has finally been destroyed. I've been trying since Genesis in the garden that I might kill Adam and Eve, and that I might take them. And I've been trying ever since that I would stick my sneaky head in there, and that I would devour them. And finally, I've caught the Christ on the cross, the devil has won. While the devil is screaming and proclaiming and hip hip hooraying, God knows in the greatest evil that ever happened, he was about to bring forth the most salvific good that ever would be. That Christ suffering and dying on the cross, how evil is that, would bring about salvation for all who would call upon his name. That's how big God is. And if he accomplished that in Christ, if he accomplished that in Joseph, we have to recognize we might not see it, but I hold fast to a good God who is not triumphed by evil, but instead triumphs over evil. He is a God who is in control, and while I might feel the real repercussions of this world's evil on me, God has a bigger plan. And that's not always a satisfactory answer. But it is the answer that Scripture gives us. And it's an answer in hope. Flip with me, because this is not the only place the Bible says this. It is not drawn just from the story of Joseph, but also Paul brings out this in Romans. Romans chapter 8 is an echo of Genesis 50:20. Romans chapter 8, verse 28. Romans 8, 28. And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. Romans 8, 28. Now we could read that verse and we could say, as many a prosperity gospel preacher has said, if you'll just trust in me, all good things will happen for you. We could read that and understand it that way. We have to recognize from Genesis 50:20, another verse that is a good cross-reference here and shows us the whole understanding of the world we're living in. It doesn't just happen that only good things happen to those who trust in God. But we can hold fast to the fact that we know God causes all things to work together, to work out to end up for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. It's interesting where Genesis 50:20 does not necessarily count it for those who would claim Christ. Romans 8:28 pulls it out and shows us in context that really, we are the only ones in this world who can hold fast to that. And some of us, as the psalmist says, why does it rain on the wicked and the good? More than that, why does it sometimes seem that the good get more rain than the wicked? Why does it seem, as the old question goes, that bad things happen to good people and vice versa? Why do good things happen to bad people? It doesn't answer that question. What it does say is that God's going to work all things out, even the bad, for those who are called by his name. We're the only ones who have that hope. And so, the larger question, how is God working that out? In my situation, in your experience. The hard truth is, while Joseph saw a good intervention by God in this world, we do not always see that. Where does God work out all things for those who are called by his purpose? Sometimes it's in heaven. Sometimes the abuser, the murderer, the liar, the cheater. Sometimes that person doesn't get what he or she deserves until he stands before the judgment seat of Christ and all wrath is poured out before them. And for those of us who have a very weak understanding of what's to come, only a hope and not a surety of the future, of the resurrection, and of a heavenly purpose in Christ, that's not a satisfying answer. I want justice now. But we have to recognize that all things will come together perfectly in the end. That person who was taken from us, that thing that was taken from us, that hurt that never healed, I can't tell you that it'll be healed in this life. I can't tell you that they'll be given back to you in this life. In fact, most of the time, the reality is it won't happen in this life. But praise God that he has promised us a place beyond this life. And there's a day to get when all things will be made new. There is a day when we will all be collected together again, and we will be known before him and before one another. That's the hope that's in Christ. And I hope that as the Joseph story has for me, and as Romans has for me, is giving you a hope for the days ahead. Because this is what Joseph puts forward here in Genesis 50 that is going to push his family ahead. Look at verse 21 with me. So therefore, Joseph says, do not be afraid. Don't be afraid that I'm going to hurt you, that I'm going to harm you, that I'm going to kill you, that I'm going to do any of these things. Don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your little ones. Joseph says, not only do you not have to be afraid because God has worked all things out and here and now in my situation, we're going to be reconciled together and all the bad is going to become good because I'm going to provide for you and your little ones. You don't have to worry. I'm going to continue doing what I've been doing. So he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. And the last section that we have, the outro to Genesis, shows us not only does this family have hope for the days ahead, not only does God's people have hope for the days ahead, but specifically, there is hope for the days ahead as we depart from Genesis into Exodus. Now, Joseph stayed in Egypt, he and his father's household, and Joseph lived 110 years. Verse 22 echoes verse 21, and it takes us from the time of the questioning by the brothers, the message of the brothers, and the promise of Joseph, I'm going to take care of you, all the way to the end of his life. And where did he live? In Egypt, with him, his family, and Jacob's family. He kept his promise. He took care of them all the way up to year 110. Verse 23. Joseph saw the third generation of Ephraim's sons. Also, the sons of Machir, son of Manasseh, were born on Joseph's knees. Not only does he take care of this family, not only is the family reconciled that there's no more enmity between them, but there's a happy ending to it. He gets to see the generations of Ephraim, and he gets to rear the grandchildren on his own knees. He gets the bouncing baby at the end. Joseph's story comes to a conclusion that is a whole lot better than it began. And we might say, I want that in this time where there's sorrow and there's hurt. We get something better than this. We don't get an earthly perspective of this bliss. We get an eternal heavenly one. And it's hard because it's out of reach, but it's not totally out of reach. It's a promise that we hang on to. And Joseph said in verse 24, and he's speaking here, it says in verse 24, to his brothers. Joseph said to his brothers, very much like his father before him, just a few verses before, I'm about to die. But God will surely take care of you. Why does he say that? Because he's the one who's currently taking care of them. He's the one who's taking care of them from verse 21 all the way to verse 22, which is a gap of some time. We don't know exactly how much. I haven't calculated it. But it's the length of his life that's left. But he says, don't fret. I'm going. But God is going to take care of you. And if anybody's equipped to take care of you, it's him. But God will surely take care of you and bring you up from the land, from this land, Egypt, to the land which he promised an oath to Abraham and to Isaac and to Jacob. Just as his father and his father's father and his father's father's father before him, they all clinged in their last days to the promise of God. It wasn't realized in Abraham. It wasn't realized in Isaac. It wasn't fully realized in Jacob. And it wasn't realized in Joseph. But he looks at them with a hope for tomorrow. God will take care of you. He will bring you to the land that he promised. Verse 25, then Joseph made the sons of Israel swear. So he says, as all the fathers did before him, swear an oath to me. But watch this oath. We might read too quickly and say it's very similar to Jacob's because the oath does say in verse 25, you shall carry my bones up from here. He wants his bones to be carried to Machpelah, just like those who were buried before him. But look at what it begins with, and this is the one that's much more important. God will surely take care of you. Swear it to me. By my body, by my children, swear it to me that God will take care of you. That you won't forsake the promise, that in what comes after this, you will remember me. You'll remember my father. You'll remember all the way back to Abraham and the promise that God made to him that he will take you up out of this land. God will surely take care of you. Promise it to me. Swear it to me. This is the promise Joseph makes with his brothers and those who will go into Egypt. So Joseph died at the age of 110 years. He was embalmed and placed in a coffin in Egypt. This is the last reminder of hope before we jump into Egypt, before we jump into Exodus. Because in the flip of a page in one verse, we're going to flip and we're going to jump 400 years into the future. And in that 400 years, good things do not happen. In fact, it mirrors what we just taught, right? That sometimes bad things are going to happen to good people, that bad things are about to happen to God's people. But God's going to bring all things to pass for his people who are called by his name, that he'll work out evil for good. And though you're about to be enslaved for 400 years, though I'm about to leave and there's going to crop up a Pharaoh in Exodus who did not know Joseph any longer and therefore hated God's people, therefore, while all these things are happening, trust God's going to take care of you. That as the good days of the patriarchs are behind us, as wicked days are before us, there's hope for the days ahead. And church, we're in a very similar place. We find ourselves somewhere in the pages between Revelation chapter 3 and 4 and somewhere in the middle. If we believe what the Bible says about what's coming, there is nothing but peril before us. It only goes downhill from here. What can we use? What can we find hope in for the days that are ahead? The same thing that Joseph found hope in. The same thing that the Egyptian Israelites will find their hope in. We can find hope in a God who has promised, though these things will come to pass, it is to work out my greater good. And on the other side of it, no matter what evils will befall you, I'm going to be victorious. It's going to bring greater glory to me. And you can hope and you can bet on it and you can find surety in the fact that though evil will come our way, there is a good God in heaven who sees it all and nothing gets by him. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We thank you for the book of Genesis, and we thank you for the truth in it. We thank you for the lessons we've learned in these past years. We thank you for the stories that we cling to and that remind us of your goodness, both now and in Christ and forevermore. Lord, we ask that as we close this chapter and we open a new one, that we would recognize these things that have befallen Joseph, that are about to befall the children of Israel, and the wickedness that befalls each and every one of us who live this life, that there is hope that is only found in you. Lord, I pray that as we go throughout the rest of this week, that you would remind us of that truth, that it would give us peace and comfort, and that even when things are impossible to understand because we do not have the divine mind, Lord, I pray that you would give us peace by your loving spirit. Lord, be with us. Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for joining us online today. Remember, you can find additional videos at these online locations. If you would like to give, you can mail your offering to First Baptist Church Brooklyn at P.O. Box 340 in Brooklyn, Mississippi, 39425. If you would like to talk to someone, you can call our church number or you can visit us for one of our in-person worship times. We hope to see you soon.